Chapter 8. Paper Route.
It was unseasonably warm for November, and the last of the Santa Ana winds had died down in the greater LA area. Workers had cleared all the trees and big branches off the streets. A man driving slowly in an old but shiny Cadillac called out,
"Hey, young man, would you like to make some money on a paper route?"
Bradley skidded his bike to a stop as the big car pulled to the curb. The rule to stay away from strangers was trumped by the promise of money, and he responded without delay.
"Yeah, when can I start?"
"How old are you?"
said the man, who introduced himself with a long name that sounded like Constantinople without the sea.
"But everyone calls me Mr. O."
He smiled and winked, which made Bradley notice the deep wrinkles in his face. A slight man in a loose gray suit complete with a hat tilted to one side. He looked like he belonged in an old gangster movie.
"I just turned 10 today."
You had to be at least 10 years old to get a paper route. Everybody knew that.
"Happy birthday, young man. I'll need you to come fill out some paperwork and have your parents sign it for permission. Call me tomorrow."
He handed the boy a business card, which Bradley promptly deposited in his jacket pocket. The man took another glance at his new paper boy, looked him up and down, and smiled again. His mouth opened to say something, but no words came out. Instead, he just tipped his hat and drove off. Bradley didn't know why, but he trusted Mr. O. Maybe it was his big shiny car, or the way his eyes twinkled. Maybe it was his polite manner and his business card. The boy had no reason to suspect the newspaper distributor. An adult would surely have caught on to his pedophile fantasies from the way he had looked Bradley over. Rather than be wary of Mr. O, Bradley pedaled home with a big grin and imagined how his earnings might help him with rent. Thanks to him, they would never get evicted again, which gave him a warm feeling all over. He pedaled faster and faster, picturing himself handing the money to his mother right in the nick of time, when she'd come up short. Natalie had just made a coconut cake, Mo's favorite. He was fresh out of LA County Jail, where he'd been on his birthday, and she wanted to celebrate belatedly. But when Bradley told her that he was getting a paper route and would help pay the bills, she cut him the first piece of cake and served it with a single candle sticking out of it.
"Happy birthday, my little angel,"
she crooned and set it down on the kitchen table as if it were a gift from heaven.
"My birthday is in 2 weeks,
he said, correcting his mother made him stare down at his shoes.
"I know,"
she said.
"I'll never forget that special day 10 years ago. I wanted you more than anything. Nobody was going to take my baby away, but Dad is home and I want to take care of him too."
There were empty beer cans on the table and he could hear Mo talking to the TV in the other room. It was hard to believe his birth was that special when she couldn't even get the day right. But he stayed excited. Forgetting that his earnings were already earmarked for rent, he figured that the $50 a month he would make would buy some clothes. Plus, Jeffrey would have lunch money at school and not get hassled by the rich kids for using their free tickets. With anything left over, Bradley would open a bank account, and as he had learned in class, the principle of compounding interest would make him wealthy by the time he finished high school. That way he could take care of the whole family, even their drunk dad. Yeah, there was no stopping him now. Natalie cut a bigger piece of coconut cake for Mo and grabbed another beer, which she delivered to him where he sat like a chieftain in his tattered armchair hollering at the fights on TV.
"Hit him! Break that sucker's jaw!" he bellowed. "Come on, punk, make me some money, damn it!"
Mo knew all about boxing. He was a fighter himself. He was also a dedicated gambler and was sure he was going to collect on this one.
"Thank you, baby,"
he said, grabbing the beer to let Natalie set the cake down on a rickety TV tray. The sound of him playfully spanking her rear and the crack of a beer can opening was music to Bradley's ears. They were happy. Bradley's only birthday present, besides the piece of coconut cake, came when he called Mr. O.
"It's Bradley, remember me? When can I start?"
He took directions down, and right after school, he showed up to a dilapidated garage off an alley behind Colorado Boulevard. Inside were a few older kids and Mr. O, who was parked at a wooden table with a cash box full of more money and coins than Bradley had ever seen in his life.
"I'm going to get rich," he thought.
He was so excited, his breath caught in his throat. There were stacks of newspapers on wooden benches and tables. Kids were folding them one at a time and stuffing them into canvas bags. One kid's hands moved so fast they were a blur. Mr. O helped Bradley fill out another form for parental signature. He knew Mom would lie about his birthday so he could start right away. They shook hands and Mr. O said,
"Congratulations, you're hired. Bring this paper back and Take care of yourself, Bradley.
Bradley pumped the pedals hard and made the 2 miles home in no time. He ran in, almost tripping over Glenn, who was playing on the floor.
Whoa, watch it, kid. What's got you so worked up?
Asked Mo. He was watching a Marlboro commercial on TV and smoking one, too. He seemed to be in a good mood, so Bradley handed him the form for Mr. O and launched into the story of his new job.
No, you can't have a paper route,
said Natalie, cutting him off.
I've thought about it, and you're going to get killed riding your bike around and throwing papers on Colorado Boulevard, and all the freaks will rip you off.
She changed her mind all the time, but this time he could tell she meant it.
Ah, come on, Nat. It's time the boy grew up, said Mo, with a hard edge to his voice. And we can sure use a little extra money around this house. Isn't that right, son? Bring that paper over here and fetch me a pen.
Natalie started to argue, but gave up. Mo had a hair-trigger temper, so why tempt fate?
Fine. I'll sign the damn thing,
she said, maintaining control over her son. Mo was not around enough to get credit for being the responsible parent.
But tell that Mr. O, you are not to deliver papers on Colorado. It has to be a nice, peaceful neighborhood.
The next day after school, Bradley was following a kid on his bike, watching him throw newspapers onto porches on residential streets. It was a small route, he learned quickly, with only 32 houses. Soon, the end of the month came, and it was time to do collections. For a shy 10-year-old, getting money from adults was a bummer. It was amazing how many had excuses why they didn't have the $3. Some didn't even come to the door, so he had to go back again and again, his pockets filling up with quarters and dollar bills that he would take straight to Mr. O, knowing better than to go home with all that money. Payday came in the middle of the second month, and Mr. O gave him $13.50 for each subscriber who paid. That's when he found out it took 100 houses, with everyone paying up, to make $50. He was mad about that for days and pushed Mr. O for an additional route that he could deliver before school. It turned out to be a bigger route, 60 houses, and the bag weighed heavily on his handlebars. Mo had just lost his welder job. He had only worked there for a couple of months when he picked a big drunken fight about it, yelling at Natalie.
If I have to work for that man one more goddamn day, I'm gonna kill him.
Now he sat around and, seeing that Bradley was working all the time, asked him how he did collections. One day, Bradley was collecting for both routes, and when his pockets and the canvas bag tied around his waist got full, he had to stop in the middle of a block and go offload the cash at Mr. O's garage. But Mo was leaning against his old Chevy as Bradley pulled up. Mr. O waved and smiled, having made new friends with his charming father. The paper distributor was very eager to please the parents of his paper boys. He didn't want them to think he had any unnatural intentions with their young sons.
Bradley, get in the car for a minute,
ordered Mo, who was freshly groomed and stone-cold sober. Bradley obeyed, not only out of fear, but because he wanted to do the right thing and believed that his dad could want that too.
Son, your mom and me are in a pretty desperate situation.
He went on, and soon had all the cash from Bradley, with an ironclad promise to pay it back before the final collections were due.
Don't worry, I'll have another job lined up.
Bradley wanted to believe him. It was why he had a paper route. Mo offered to put the bike in the car and drive him home, but Bradley wanted to ride himself. Full of happy energy, he rode like the wind. Bradley beat his father home and waited for him, so he could give his father the chance to thank him again. But Mo didn't come home at all that day, or the next. Later, Bradley learned from overhearing his parents' drunken fight that Mo had gone to Santa Anita and lost the paper route money on a horse race. Almost $200. When Bradley told Mr. O, he was understanding like Jesus, and it made the boy wish his boss was his father. That evening, after the last kid left, Bradley was alone with Mr. O, who came and hugged him a little too long and too close. Finally, Bradley pushed him away. Nobody had ever hugged him like that before, and he didn't like it. Bradley had to repay every dollar working both routes for no take-home pay for 3 months. Mo never mentioned the money again.